That's a good song. Freedom, as you know, is quite important. It's partly what makes you, you. Don't forfeit it. Unless it's to transcend to your true you.
But that's true freedom, right?
But that's true freedom. Yeah. True freedom is to give oneself.
Fulfillment of freedom.
Yeah. Okay. Welcome. Welcome back. So I want to start with noting that this is our last day actually talking about kind of going through the work, Clark's work. On Friday, we are going to, Dr. Shinkavich and I are going to do kind of a live little discussion, a Zoom. We're gonna zoom.
I'll be zooming around.
Zooming around, Atchison, and wherever you are, asking questions to each other. Hopefully, having you all ask questions. I sent out that email. So that's this Friday, which I think is a little ahead of schedule. So you might not actually be listening to this until after we've already zoomed. But that's okay.
But you sent an email.
But I sent an email, and then. There was also a question that was asked that's going to be a good sort of recap summary, because this is always good to return to this. But it was a question about what is the meaning of being as self-communication, and why is being self-communication? And kind of talk about that. And so I said, okay, I'll talk a little bit about that. And I think... The one of the best ways, at least for me, to think about this is that being is, for Thomas, the act of all acts. So it's the primary activity of existing things, which sort of, I don't want to, I'll use the word anyway, it enables them to do all of their characteristic activities. So you might think, what is it to be a tree? It's to grow. It's to take in nutrients. It's to shine forth colors and beauty and what have you. But prior to growing and prior to taking in nutrients and shining forth beauty, it has to do something. No, it doesn't have to do something temporally, but it has to do something prior metaphysically or ontologically. It has to be, right? It has to exist in order for it to grow. It has to exist in order for it to shine forth colors and what have you. So being is a type of act, you can say, but it's unlike any other type of act because it's kind of the underlying act that allows all the secondary acts or activities of a creature to come to light. So it's I used this analogy before. It's an analogy Thomas himself uses, that it's the light that brings into view all of the realities of that creature. So this is why being, esse, the act itself, is not seen, so to speak. What you see, what you experience, is the thing itself, but it wouldn't be like the ends, the creature, the being, not as in the sense of acts, but the entity itself is what you encounter, what you experience, but only in virtue of this gift of the active being, which is sort of the light that makes the essence play itself out and communicate. So it's sort of that which gives the ability to communicate, the act of communication, the act of sort of making itself known and present and real to other things, because that's what it is to be. To be is to make yourself real. And what is it to make yourself real? It's to make yourself interact, to do stuff. So for Thomas, being is this type of actuality. It's this type of engagement with something. So perfectly stagnant, non-active, non-doing, non-revealing entity would be, as he says, non-existent. It would be no different from non-existence.
Yeah, I was actually looking for that passage right when you were saying that, because I was thinking of that exact one where he says, suppose that there's something that can't be seen or known. He said, it would be as if it didn't exist. In fact,
yeah,
it would be equivalent to non-existence. It would
be equivalent, yeah. I think it's in the early... Yeah, here, this is 12:13.
Oh, wow. Wait, really?
Yeah, it's right at the very beginning. There would... The bottom of 12, I believe. There would be no... maybe you set up.
You suppose.
Suppose a being that really exists but does not act in any way, does not manifest itself in any way to other beings. There would be no way for anything else to know that it exists. It would make no difference at all to the rest of reality. Practically speaking, it might just as well not be at all. It would, in fact, be indistinguishable from non-being. Right? So even the idea of a being that completely lacks activity would even lack activity to itself or in itself.
To be itself.
Right? To be itself, right? So in some ways, to be you requires that you... You do something. To be a human is to do something. To be a tree is to do something. To be an angel is to do something. To be the sun, in some sense of do, right?
Yeah.
Whatever that means, is to do something.
Yeah.
And whatever something is.
Right.
So I think what you see is that being is this type of activity. Essence or nature is the limitation on what type of activity is being manifested or being done. So the degree to which you fail at the activities of your nature, or the degree to which you fail at acting as a human, is the degree to which you fail at being. Right. So this is why at the end of the reading for today, he says to not communicate yourself to another, to not, you know, freely strive for the good and to strive for the intelligible, the true, is the degree to which you fail as a person. And therefore, you sort of fail as being and you move towards non-being. And that's what evil consists in, is this failing to act according to your nature. And so I think self-communication is central to being, partly because what Clark is saying is that's just what being is. And why is being that way? And he says, well, I don't know.
It's like a first principle. You
can't
really ask.
Yeah, why is God this way?
Why is there something rather than nothing?
Why is God Trinitarian?
Yeah. Is that a way?
Yeah.
That's the key, right? I think that's the real key. That we're equating it so much that we're just, as we say that God's being Trinity isn't a way of being, but it's just being.
Right.
So do I want to say that action isn't a way of being. It's just being.
Right. Yeah. And then action can be said in two senses. Or there's probably a multitude of senses, but at least two senses here. It's the fundamental act. And then you have the secondary acts. And the secondary acts are the ones you're all very familiar with.
And maybe obsessed with.
And maybe obsessed with.
Yeah.
Hitting baseballs and climbing trees. And these are good things to be doing. And reading Clark and talking to friends.
Watching Scooby-Doo.
And watching Scooby-Doo some of the time. And drinking beer and playing the banjo with Pete Seeger and all this. I mean, great things to do. But none of that activity could ever come to light if there wasn't that primary act of existing, sort of striving to do something, right? Uh-huh. To be is to strive to do something, and then it's the nature, which is what this is a sort of a bad analogy, but kind of got to go with that if you're trying to broadly talk about that, which you can't really talk about, that is being itself apart from essence. But you can kind of think of essence as guiding or orienting the act of being along a particular path so that it shines forth in a particular way. Because otherwise, you don't really have communication going on. Like if you're trying to think about what to say and there's just too many, you think I could say this way, this way, this way, this way, this way, or this way, and you go on, and perhaps there's an infinite number of ways, then you're not going to be able to say anything, or you won't say anything. So you can only speak or communicate or have meaning come forth and be present if it's limited in a certain way. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But yet before that limiting, there's got to be something that's striving for the light of communication, that's striving for the light of being. But you have to sort of rein it in into a particular mm-hmm. way, even knowing, okay, by doing this, this happens when I teach, which is why I think I stutter a lot and always go back and say, no, that's not quite right. Or maybe I shouldn't say that, or right in the middle of a thought, because I realize as I'm saying it, that this is limiting what I'm trying to say in a particular way that makes the point not exactly how I want to make it. Uh-huh. But if I don't just carry the thought through, then nothing is going to ever really be said, because everything you say, just as everything that exists, is not that everything that exists is not the perfection of being itself, because it's just a being. It's one way of existing. That if you were to say, no, 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 don't have that because that's not perfect being. No, don't have that. That's not perfect being. Then what you're going to be left with is nothing. Just yeah. as if you say, no, that's not the best way to say it. I really want to tell my wife that I love her, and I'm trying to think of the best way. No, don't say it that way. Don't say it that way, because that's going to be too simple or too simple. And then eventually you're just left not doing anything.
And then she's frowning.
And then she's frowning. Why did you say you loved me? And I say, because I love you so much, I don't know how to say it.
But I shouldn't have even said that. No, yeah. That's not
yeah.
enough.
Yeah. And so I we've all been in these experiences where you realize you kind of have to settle for a way or a gift, realizing this isn't the best gift to give this person or the best thing to say or the best thing to do, but you just sort of quote-unquote settle for it. But paradoxically, I think by settling for that, you realize you've done something real, which was an expression of your love or your friendship or your whatever it is you're expressing. I guess if being's love, then it's definitely love that's being expressed.
Right.
And then you realize that's better than nothing, right? Love doesn't get expressed by not doing anything because it's just so great. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the temptation for metaphysicians. It's to say being is so great that I can't look to any particular being in order to understand being itself, because being itself isn't a flower. Being itself isn't a tree. Mm-hmm. Being itself isn't a human. So I can't think about being or even God by looking at trees or looking at humans. And I think to do that is to fall into that temptation of saying non-being is better than being. Mm-hmm. The best way to get to being itself is to not approach individual particular beings. Mm-hmm. So I think, I don't know if maybe that just made things more complicated about why being is self-communication. But he uses that's a phrase of St. Thomas. And I like that he talks about being something that we tend to think of as this like static, isolated individual
being there
thing, being there. And he actually puts it in kind of a linguistic framework. It becomes a dialogical uh-huh. reality, that it's just as a word doesn't have any meaning unless it's spoken to another. Being doesn't have any meaning or any reality unless it's present to another.
Mm-hmm.
So he's trying to make this connection between the presencing of one thing to another is what that reality consists in,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Which is, I mean, that's language. Language only makes sense. It's only a reality in light of the giving of something to another, and that's why Clark then transitions from that into why being is relational, because when you realize that you're self communication, then you realize there's got to be a we, mm-hmm. right? Just as when you realize language is dialogical, you realize that means there must be those that I'm speaking to.
Mm-hmm.
So, and this is if you should go on and read other stuff of Clark if you're interested, because he critiques the early modern epistemology, especially Descartes, to say Descartes' epistemology of how do I know? We were going to read Descartes, sorry, folks, we're not. but Descartes wondering how do I know there's an external world? And Clark says, you're a moron if you don't know there's an external world, because you don't even know there would be language then.
Yeah.
Right? You don't even know that there would be being. Right? And since you know that there's language, since you know that there's being, there has to be an external world, because there has to be something that is sort of the subject or that to which you are
communicating.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So basically, if there's love, there has to be a world.
Yeah.
Right? And he says, of course there's love because there's being.
Yeah. 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 This is, I think this is really fascinating. And I think this, in a sense, what you're saying is being is itself a language.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Being is language. It is communication to another thing.
Yeah.
But it's a language that's almost, it's like the language of languages. You do need to learn to know it, but you don't, it's not in a sense, I mean, it is, but it's not completely culturally context. There's a great passage in Augustine where he talks about, maybe this isn't his confessions. This is all I think about now, because little confessions every day.
Yeah.
But he says something along the lines of how the facial expressions of a human person are universal. And so it doesn't matter if you know Hebrew or Greek or Latin, when you see an angry red face, you know what that means.
Right, right.
It's a communication. But that's a way of being, right? When you are angry, you are communicating yourself to others by your very being. But I think what we're trying to do is explode that into everything.
Right.
And not just say the angry face communicates something, but that the anything, right?
Right.
That bees communicate something.
Yeah, yeah. And what is it that being communicates?
Itself. Not itself.
Yeah, no. I think it communicates itself, but what is itself?
Oh. A communication.
Yeah.
Of being itself.
Yeah. So. So I think, like, what's, and I liked how you said itself, because otherwise you become a monist.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. but I was trying to cut corners a little too quickly.
Yeah.
Okay. So
you kind of looked at me like, what?
Yeah. So when you think about, I guess when you look at a friend, or you hear a friend speaking, and sometimes you have these moments, you realize like, I would never have thought that this person would have said this or done this. Not that, like, because it's so, like, wrong or...
Although that's true, too.
Sometimes that happens, yeah. But sometimes because you just never would have put it that way, or,
uh-huh.
Right? And sometimes when you're speaking to a friend, you realize, wow, I never would have put it that way, but I did put it that way. right? And you kind of realize that there's this great... this great mystery, which is present to you, and it's that individual friend or that individual spouse or that individual sibling or child that's present, but mm-hmm. you come to see in their very presence, their limited, simple presence, something far greater than just that simple presence. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like we got chickens.
Yes.
Chicks. We got a bunch of baby hens.
Hopefully hens, hopefully.
Hopefully. We were told they were hens. And when kids, little kids, look at little chicks, even adults, but especially children, when they look at these little chicks, they see more than just tiny little animals that are going to lay eggs and hopefully five months. Hopefully 5 months. They see something more than that.
And they see the whole.
The whole. They see the Gestalt. Right. But it's true. Yeah.
Right. There's something about the chick that within which they see everything, and that's why. That's what we call wonder, right? I mean, that's what wonder is. It's the ability to, in the particular, see the universal.
Yeah.
To see everything.
Yeah, and not by moving past the particular. So it's not, thank you, chick, for letting me see beauty itself.
Now get out of my way.
Now get out of the way so I can look at it.
Yeah.
Right. If it wasn't for those little fuzzy fuzzes on the back of those little fuzzy fuzz balls, I wouldn't see beauty itself.
Right.
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 So there's,
which is a mystery.
Yeah.
A huge mystery.
So, and this is, I think what's unique about Christianity is that it makes the particular, possible to reveal as particular the universal, the all.
I mean, I don't know that I would say it makes it, but it reveals that it does. Does it transform the particular?
I think what you have,
maybe it transforms the seer.
I think what you have in Jesus Christ is the revelation of the universal as
a particular.
Particular. Right. And I think you realize this is why it's an actual incarnation, not just simply a platonic resemblance or a platonic modeling of. Although perhaps Plato would say maybe the perfect modeling of, but it's still a model of the form itself, because it's physical. And I think in Christianity you have that the physical reality is opened into, it opens into the infinite, so that as the infinite can be physical, you can experience the infinite not simply through the physical, I think you experience it in its physicality.
You see him with your own eyes and handle him with your own hands.
Right. So that in some ways it goes even, I mean, this is super radical, but it goes beyond the although very beautiful idea of the Platonic icon, the physical world is an icon of the good. I think it goes beyond that. It actually makes the good physical. The good becomes physical, right? And so not in the sense of a window, right? But in the sense of, or a mirror, but a sense of
abiding,
dwelling, dwells among us.
Yeah.
And I think that is quite radical.
Yeah. You think these chicks realize how awesome they are?
I don't know. No, they don't. And that's why we're here.
We have to.
That is our calling in life.
We recognize their awesomeness for them.
If you don't recognize what the baby chick is, then you fail.
You have failed creation.
And you, you have let creation down.
Yeah. Which, if you've never seen a baby chick,
Well, you kind of already have.
Maybe on Friday. Maybe on Friday we'll bring some chicks.
Oh yeah, we'll bring some chicks down. Yeah. So if you want to, you'll still see only an image of it on your screen.
Yeah, but
but it's closer.
But you will at least hopefully. So that will be the icon.
I thought you were going to say that'll be the incentive to come to the Zoom meeting.
No. Yeah, no, that it will too. Be. That will too. But that will be an icon of the reality. So I think that's maybe what you have is mm-hmm. is you have the what Plato has. This is interesting. Plato has sort of opened up this possibility of the notion of an icon. But even Plato, I think, is still in the cave.
Mm-hmm.
Because he sees...
Which you can't get out of the cave on your own, right?
Right.
We're going to talk about
that. Because he's seeing the world... he's seeing the world as an icon. Which is... Yeah, that's good. But I think what he is missing, and this is no fault of his own, is that he's missing that the world actually isn't an icon. The world is... I mean, is now, in light of the incarnation... Him. I mean, it's the presence of the Father,
mm-hmm.
Sort of through creation, through the Word, so that he who has seen me has seen the Father, and it's not in this monistic sort of way,
mm-hmm.
because you still have individuality, but you ultimately, I think, see the speaker. You hear the speaker when you hear the word, and so you mm-hmm. see the creator when you see the creature, not merely as a resemblance or this is sort of moving towards God, and therefore I can kind of quote unquote see God through the striving that this thing has towards God. Although that's good to recognize, I think that's incomplete.
I know we need to move into Clark here, but let me ask one question here.
we're just jamming.
Hopefully this doesn't derail completely. But when I look at a chick and Plato looks at a chick,
mm-hmm.
do I see the chick for what it really is because I have eyes to see? Or do I now see something that's actually – is the chick actually different because of the incarnation? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Like, is it a change in the subject, or is it a change in the object, or is it both? Like, has Christ elevated chickdom by becoming man?
Has he changed human? Does the incarnation change human nature?
Into another nature? It makes it transcend itself.
Yeah. So I think just as man becomes self-transcendent,
all of creation.
I think the known, the knower becomes self-transcendent. But I think perhaps you can also say the known becomes in some ways self-transcendent, although non
maybe other transcendent.
By
being known.
Non. But I think what's weird is it becomes non-consciously self-transcendent.
Yeah.
It becomes self-transcendent, although it doesn't know how good it's got it.
Yeah.
It doesn't know how good it is.
Yeah. So maybe this is taking just very seriously the foundation of relationality and sort of helps further blow apart the sort of individualization of substances in such a way that if I'm transformed and I know my... golden lace Seabright chick, not the golden lace one. The blue lace wine. No, the lavender Orpington.
Okay. Oh.
The lavender Orpington, which
good choice.
My kids have named Bruce Springsteen because it's the boss. Because I know Bruce, the lavender Orpington, and I have transcended myself in baptism.
Yeah.
Bruce transcends chickdom
by
his relationality directly, physically, incarnationally to me.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think...
And maybe that's what it just means for man to bring creation. I mean, this is what Clark was talking about, to bring creation, bring the cosmos up with him, which is, I think, how we ended our last section.
Yeah.
We were talking about how man, maybe it was two sections ago, but this idea of the cosmos being the thing that is brought up to its perfection by man.
Yeah, and I think doesn't St. Paul begins the letter to the Ephesians, I think, with this, yeah, chapter 11, Ephesians 1:11. In him we were also chosen, destined in accord with the purpose of the one who accomplishes all things according to the intentions of his will, so that we might exist for the praise of his glory, we who first hoped in Christ. In him, it's somewhere, I know it's in here.
What are you looking
for? To bring all things, and he put all things beneath his feet and gave him his head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of the one who fills all things in every way. But the idea that all things be brought to fullness, I'm almost positive. Someone can find it, I'm sure.
Make a comment.
Yeah, make a comment. I'm sure somewhere
in Scripture,
as Gregory Nyssa often says, somewhere in Scripture it says that was the purpose was to bring all things to fullness together in Him.
Like so that God will be all in all.
So that God will be all in all.
Yeah, right? I don't know where that is either.
So that we might bring glory to those that can't.
Bring glory to themselves. Yeah, that's the reason it seems to be, and I think Clark is agreeing with this, it seems to be that that's the reason why there are embodied spirits, that all that is embodied, that are all non-spiritual bodies, can be brought to a fullness through the embodied spirit.
Yeah.
So, anyway, we should get into the text here. Right?
But that was great stuff.
Yeah, that was... Very fun there.
That was great. Okay. But I think that's related. I mean,
it's totally related.
It's all related. Get it? Totally it's related. All related.
Yeah, of course it is.
Because it's being.
In fact, it's all relation.
That's good.
Which is why he gets into the beginning here with receptivity, right?
Yeah.
And receptivity being a positive perfection. Right? He talks about friendship, which I think is fascinatingly a great place to go. I would have never thought to go there for receptivity. Mm-hmm. But I think it's really helpful. But I think this is one of the things that I've really loved about this book is just – and I think I mentioned this in another podcast, but just how Clark is a true philosopher who takes into account all truth. And he continually would go back to the Trinity. He does not say the Trinity is for theologians. Let's not talk about it.
Yeah.
Or the Trinity is revelation. Therefore, philosophy is not about revelation. Philosophy is about finding the heart of truth in whatever way possible, right? Taking into account everything, including revelation. So he continually goes back to the Trinity. And I love how he puts it here on page 86. I mean, I am happy to admit my full indebtedness mm-hmm. is to the profound and daring speculation of the Swiss Catholic theologian Hans Urs von Balthasar. Because Balthasar is the one who really brings out the Trinitarian implication, if the Trinity is what being is and everything participates in that, which is the heart of what Clark keeps bringing up,
right?
The Trinity is what being is. It's not a mode of being that God is. It's not, isn't that interesting that he's like that?
Yeah.
No, he's not like anything.
Yeah.
He just is that.
And it's not that.
So everything that is that way.
Yeah. And it's not.
But not a way, right?
Yeah.
It's
yeah,
just
yeah.
what being is.
Yeah. The Trinity or the triuneness is not something that's added on to being.
Right.
So you say, okay, you have God. And then here's the thing you add onto being.
Yeah, you have to think of it as triune too.
The threeness. You have the oneness of being.
Right.
And then you'd say, okay, here's this other thing that sort of is an add-on, a following, a modification,
an accident.
An accident.
I mean, we would always say, it's not an accident. But what we really mean is that.
Yeah. Right. And I think there's a temptation among Thomists to do this because of the way Thomas treats. The book one of the Summa.
De Deo Uno, De Deo Trino. Kind of
yeah, thing. Yeah. So you begin with the oneness of God, and then you push on to, okay, that's being itself, and then you now need to, like, sort of do something, mm-hmm. some additional work to the oneness of God.
Right.
But I think what Clark is saying, no, it turns out that the oneness of God is its Trinitarian.
Yeah. It's what Ratzinger calls, it's a multi-unity.
Yeah, a multi-unity.
A multi-unity.
A plural-unity.
Yeah, exactly. It's beyond plurality and unity, as Ratzinger says. But I love how he does this here in 86 and 87, where he says, listen, this is the reason why I'm saying receptivity is a positive perfection. It's because God is receptive.
Yeah.
And specifically, he mentions the Son. But he says, and he kind of puts in parentheses a couple places, the Holy Spirit as well. I'm not sure he knows what to do with the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, I know. I get
which is just a Western problem, yep. Right? Okay, yep. So.
Yeah, read Lopez.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, Lopez's dissertation is on Holy Spirit as gift. Yeah. But he makes a comment here at the top of 87, which I think is really important. He says, within the unity of the Supreme Being, the Father is subsistent self-communication. Get that, right? Starting with our the original question.
Yep.
While the Son is subsistent receptivity, the Holy Spirit is well in its own unique mode. But I put on the side here. I was like, wait a second. The Holy Spirit is subsistent receptivity. The Son is subsistent receptivity and communication, right? And so there's something about the Son that is communicative as well. But this is only true in a filioque context or a dia filios. Dia huios or huiu. Is it genitive? I don't remember. Mm. But, it's only when we really understand the Holy Spirit comes from the Father through the Son that we have to say, no, the Son isn't subsistent receptivity. It's the Spirit that is. And so if we're going to really talk about receptivity as a primary perfection, and we recognize, as we did in my NISA class, the Holy Spirit is divine, then we have to say subsistent receptivity is really what the Holy Spirit is.
Right, yeah. And this is why, we're in the image of God, but why is uniquely the Son that we're the image of, because of, and this is what Clark is trying to play out, is that we are both receptivity and
communication. Yeah.
Right. Which is in light of this.
But Clark doesn't, you're actually going beyond Clark because he doesn't actually point that out because I don't think he recognizes or isn't bringing it out here.
Because he seems to be saying the Father, so we're communicative. And that's sort of the image of the Father. We get that from the
Although
Father.
I don't think he says that, does he? When he calls himself self-communication.
Self-communication and then self-receptivity. So you have the one aspect is from the Father. The other aspect is from the Son.
Yeah.
And that's kind of from the Spirit, too.
Which is a very Western myth.
Yeah. Right. As Karl Rahner once said in, I forget what the book, short little book on the Holy Spirit.
On the Trinity?
On the Trinity, yeah.
Yeah.
And he says, for most modern Christians, it wouldn't matter one lick whether or not the Holy Spirit existed for them, which is scary.
Yeah, which is horrible.
Right.
So, but I think we're retrieving a true understanding. So, so the reason that what you're trying to say, I think, the reason that we're in the Son is because we're both communicative and receptive.
Right, which is exactly to also say, therefore, we're in the image of the Father and the Holy Spirit, because Son is
the middle term.
Himself, sort of the image of the Father, the Word of the Father, and the speaking of the
The breathing forth of the Spirit.
So that's good. And can we continue that quote? Because
go for it.
So those that were there on the last day. And by the last day, I mean the last day that we met in class. many of you. I won't make this too harsh. Many of you, like those that left at the foot of the cross,
or at John 6 when he said, "My flesh is true, is true food, and my blood is true drink,"
and they departed. So some of you were not there on the last day that we had class, but some of you were, and we talked about the Louth article. That was the last discourse that I gave to my people.
on the mount.
You remember, and at the very end, the final paragraph, I quoted it in both of my classes, the final paragraph of the Louth article in Plotinus says, but this is not Christian mysticism. Mm-hmm. Plotinian mysticism is not Christian mysticism, because Plotinus doesn't think that the one has any concern for those that are pursuing him. And in some ways, the pursuer of the one doesn't have any concern at the end of the day, any concern other than the self for others. So the reason you're concerned with the others that are pursuing the one is because you sort of see that they are you. You kind of like transcend their otherness, and you sort of like sublated into this unity, and you sort of recognize that they're actually not other. And so you move into this ultimate oneness, which is very close, I think, to love, but it's not love, because love doesn't collapse the distinction.
It doesn't consume one into oneself.
Yeah, it doesn't consume the other into self, but rather it foregoes the self for the other. So so rather than there being like perfect unity, Christian mysticism, rooted in a Christian metaphysics like Aquinas's, you have a unity coming about by a foregoing of self, mm-hmm. or foregoing in some ways of one of me. And so I like how Clark puts this at 87, the middle paragraph there. The highest instance of being is a unity that is not solitary, like Plotinus's one, uh-huh. but communion. Mm-hmm. So perfect unity, the good itself, the one itself, is perfect communion, mm-hmm. which is to say there's perfect difference. There's got to be difference. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you just get the communion dissolving into an essence block, an isolated essence block that has no concern for other.
But worse than that, I mean, going back to what we quoted on page 12, if there's nothing to communicate yourself to, then the unity doesn't collapse into an essence block, it collapses into a nothing.
Yeah.
If we really do equate doing and being, if we really do equate communication and being, then if there's just the one, the Plotinian one, that communicates to nothing, then it is nothing.
Yeah. This is why the Trinity is very, very important, and that in some ways the communication
that's inner like life, the most understatement of the year, by the way.
Yeah, or of eternity.
Anyway, sorry.
The communication is not something that you should ever think of as being brought to completion, mm-hmm. such that okay now. The fullness of the Father has been communicated to mm-hmm. the Son, and he's received it and communicated it to the Spirit. Mm-hmm. Because I think once you do that, then you've brought being to an end. Mm-hmm. You've then limited it, and you said, okay, it's not being anymore, because there's no more. Unless you say, okay, now he's got to like communicate to something else, and then you run this risk of like.
Yeah.
Like
then he needs creation to be perfected.
Yeah, then creation becomes God. Because it's the relation between the created world and right. God is the same as the relation between the Son and the Father.
Right.
And you run into all these really bad heresies that play out in most of.
Yeah, which is why I think that the debate on Christology, wherein which of course is Trinitarian debate too, right? Wherein the anti-Arian debate, where Alexander of Alexandria, the Bishop of Alexandria, Arius' bishop, mm-hmm. said he's the one who came up with the phraseology of eternally begotten. And the fact of eternally begotten is this never, it's not a finished, whatever that means, begetting, but it is an always already getting right? It's always happening, uh-huh. but even always,
but it's
isn't
always,
good enough, right?
And it's eternal, yeah, and it's always completed
but as begetting,
as uncompleted,
yeah. Exactly. Well, of course, right? you have to do that but I think this idea of love, which is contrasted to the Plotinian one, it really gets us into the heart of the end of this section too, where he talks about self-transcendence,
yeah,
right? Because like on page 107, he talks about the paradox of our final end, right?
Oh, yeah.
He says, the only way it can reach its full fullness of perfection as spirit is precisely to transcend its own and any other limited viewpoint, take on the divine point of view for knowing and loving all things, including itself. So not only do you love the other as the other, but you kind of love yourself as the other.
Yeah, because you love yourself as, I mean, this was great. You love yourself and you know yourself as God knows yourself
right.
and loves yourself.
Right.
So it's this. It's and
this
that's,
is Zosima, by the way.
Yeah, and I think that's to really more Dostoevsky for you out there. chalk that one up on the whiteboard. the references.
I hope you're reading your brother's Karamazov. Yeah.
But I think you have that really being what it is to live according to divine providence, to let go of your own life,
mm-hmm.
and it's to, as he says. Was that in here?
Yeah, 107 at the bottom. The fullness of personal development turns out to be losing or letting go of oneself. That is simultaneously and by that very fact, a new finding of oneself at a deeper level.
Is he the one that quotes Paul, or is that Nyssa? It's no longer I that live, but Christ who lives in me.
I think he does.
Yeah. And I think that's one way to make sense
Galatians
of this is that what in the world does he mean, he being Paul, when you say it's no longer I that live, but
yeah, it's on
Christ.
102. Actually, it's Lonergan quoted by.
Oh, there you go.
Quoted by him.
Yeah.
Although I think he quotes him somewhere else too.
Yeah. But I think that idea that you are living a divine life now.
Mm-hmm.
It's to see that you. It's not to. It. He says, "Oh, this is kind of a Buddhist insight that they kind of came to." And I think there's a sense in which there's a lot of similarity, and it's a Platonian sort of thing too, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, so you can sort of definitely see the Neoplatonism at work in St. Thomas here, very heavily.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's not simply. You have to just lose yourself into like this nothing third person perspective. I think is what is a temptation that people have. If you're going to live by according to divine providence, you kind of have to be somewhat disengaged from my own will and my own knowing, because otherwise I'm going to get too caught up in my own projects, and I'm not going to live according to God's projects. But
that's exactly the problem of, univocity of causality, right?
Yeah.
Again,
yeah.
Right? God causes only insofar as I don't cause. And that's just bogus, right?
Right.
To quote Bill and Ted.
Yeah, that's bogus. Or excellent.
Now we're looking for the excellent.
Yeah, we're looking for excellent. So it's not excellent, but that is Bill and Ted. So the decentering of consciousness I liked.
The decentering of the self.
The decentering of self.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking 98. He says that what we do is we don't see the center of our lives as us. But in some ways, what we do.
Galatians 2:20 on the next page.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah.
We also turn to the other in some ways as the center of our lives. So he has this horizontal self-transcendence he talks about.
Uh-huh.
So to transcend yourself horizontally is to see that your life is actually in the other.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what makes the pagan can do this. This is why the pagan saw an immortality in death, not because their souls separated and they were these like ghosts that now could exist without bodies, but they saw their life was capable of being in some sense immortal or existing past their death, because their life was actually the life of their people, their family, the life of their city state. And
uh-huh.
So if they gave their life for Athens, And Athens survives. They survive because
mm-hmm.
Athens is their life. Right?
Uh-huh.
So this self-transcendence in this horizontal plane, I think is a really common idea in antiquity, that you can live through and in the life of this broader non-egotistical reality, which would say your family. But he's also saying there's a vertical self-transcendence when you look at your life as not about other goods in this domain of limited goods, but there's this good which is good itself that I want to be the center of my life. I don't want simply, these aren't exclusive, I think.
No, they can't be.
I think it'll be that you can't have the vertical transcendence without the horizontal. And this is exactly what we saw in the Hadot book, that if you experience the one, you can't then not see your neighbor as like the physical at that lower level manifestation or revelation of the one. So to treat that as unimportant is to not respect the vertical transcendence that you have.
He who says he loves God and hates his neighbor is a liar.
There you go. That's better than Plotinus. but I loved the description he gave, the idea of the vertical transcendence, horizontal transcendence.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, really, and that the person is the one who is oriented towards that. So in some ways he says somewhere the person mm-hmm. is the one, the human person is the one who realizes that the point of being human is to be more than human. Doesn't he say towards the end, I believe.
Yeah.
He calls it the paradox of personal development of 107, 108. Only by reaching beyond the human can we succeed in becoming fully human.
Yep.
To refuse to do so condemns us to fall short of the human itself. To be a human person fully means to self-transcend toward the infinite. And we even call the person who doesn't love, the person who doesn't seek knowledge above like the bodily life, we call them brutes. We call them animals, right? They're living the life of an animal. So I think this idea of the human by nature, and this is such a paradox, being more than human in virtue of this infinite dynamism of intellect and will, and therefore of freedom and love, it becomes this I think dense in the sense of like chocolate cake, dense, rich. Spiritual foundation, right? Uh-huh. I think this is a really rich metaphysical foundation
mm-hmm.
to enter into a really deep, if you want to call it spiritual life, but maybe it's just a human life.
Yeah, yeah.
As he indicates.
Yeah, yeah. But I think, I think he's just saying what we've talked about a lot before, the great document from the ITC under Ratzinger, that true homogenization is divinization. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But you know, he has in the midst of this very interesting, and as I read this, I was saddened because our freedom, it's not an automatic movement, right?
Yeah.
Page 104 at the bottom, he talks about what I call the stagnators, because he says they stagnate, right?
Yeah.
He says this movement towards self-transcendence is not an automatic one. Some heed the call and keep growing, discover their deeper or true selves in the process. Some do not. They stagnate, wonder what is wrong with them now that the old ways of self-fulfillment no longer seem to work as effectively as before. They become restless, wander on the horizontal level, looking for new challenges, new stimuli that will fill the mysterious void they feel developing, but avoiding the shift to a new self-transcending level of consciousness that will allow them to move forward again.
And
really sad.
but I think it's sad, it's definitely sad the way that ends. But the some do not, they stagnate, wonder what is wrong. And so they go looking and they think, what's going to satiate my insatiable appetite?
Yeah.
What's going to rest my restless heart? And I think they're on the path to vertical transcendence.
Right.
So this is the unsatisfactory nature of horizontal life is a good thing,
right,
to latch onto. I think, right, you should recognize in some sense that, I mean, doesn't mean you should forego a vertical, or sorry, the horizontal life. You should forego loving your neighbor,
right,
or, you know, being concerned about, you know, playing frisbee with your kids, because that's not loving God.
Right.
No, but there's something. If that's all there was, if all, right, there was, if all the point of playing frisbee was to throw a plastic, you know, circular piece through the air.
Yeah.
If that's all it was, and it gave you this little like joyous feeling when you caught it, then it would be meaningless, right? Right. It would be absurd. This would be a completely pointless existence. And there are people, I think, when they realize that's all that's before me, that's it.
Yeah.
And they get this, I think, this restless emptiness. And I think that moves, you know, that opens up, that doesn't necessarily move, but it opens up the possibility,
right,
for vertical transcendence.
Because, right,
they're searching for a meaning that has to transcend the vertical.
Right.
Or sorry, that has to transcend the horizontal. And so that opens up the transcendence of the vertical. So it's tragic, but I think it's like that beauty, the beautiful tragedy of the Augustinian life.
Uh-huh.
Uh-huh. That sort of, for most of us, is necessary to have a vertical transcendence.
Right.
You have to sort of be unsatisfied.
Yeah, there's something bound up in our own seeking of satisfaction in this world, which is by nature frustrating, in order to move us to the transcendent.
Yeah.
And so Augustine's frisbee throwing was his pear stealing, right? The pear stealing, where he was like, why did I do this?
Mm-hmm.
What was the point?
Yeah.
Why did I see? These pears weren't even that good.
Yeah. I just threw
them
on the ground.
I had plenty of pears.
Yeah.
I threw them to the pigs.
Yeah.
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 And he goes, and even if I ate some, it wasn't because I wanted to eat them.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this mystery of his own activity, his own sort of nihilistic activity, made him wonder at being.
Yeah.
In a way that said, there has to be something more than pears.
Yeah. So it's like, my life isn't about me. Maybe it's about the pears. Maybe it's not about the pears. Maybe it's about my friend. I forget the friend's name who dies.
Alypius.
And maybe it's not about him, but maybe it's about, and he's like putting it, maybe it's about, you know, being a great rhetorician or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And he's like putting it, so he's looking for this horizontal transcendence.
Right.
And then eventually it's just, he realizes it's not a horizontal transcendence that's going to satisfy.
Right.
And the great paradox is, you realize that the vertical transcendence gives an insight into all of those horizontal domain, that
right.
horizontal domain that makes you realize my search for the pears and my search for mastering rhetoric was itself a search for God.
Right.
The horizontal transcendence is a participation in vertical transcendence.
Right.
But you can only see that after
right.
having...
Yeah, because the natural, the great dynamo, right, as he says on page 99, what's the dynamo behind this ecstatic decentering movement? It's the pull of the infinite good, drawing the whole person as finite spirit toward the total fulfillment it longs for, at first implicitly, finally more explicitly, by union with the infinite good, right? Because we're only satisfied, as he puts it, by the total plenitude of being as true, good, and beautiful, which I think is really... important, but you know, one I know we're running out of time here. One other point on 102, his quote from Lonergan again, is trying to make his point that it's, we always think of sort of the perfection of human nature being our movement upwards, but he says really it's about the, it flows primarily, as he says above that quote, flows primarily from above downwards, transforming us from above. And so this is the idea that self-transcendence isn't something that I cause myself, or it wouldn't be transcendent.
Right.
It would be natural, and it would be by my own power, right?
Yeah.
It would be self-fulfillment.
Yeah.
But instead, my own fulfillment only comes by transcendence, but transcendence can only come from something that's above me, right? That transcends me.
Yeah.
I can't transcend myself.
This is why, even at the horizontal level, you realize people that make occupational decisions that are it's genuine. They realize something is calling them to this. Like it's my family which is calling me to do X, Y, and Z. Mm-hmm. It's the city state that I love so well. It's the motherland which is calling me to give my life to it. Mm-hmm. And you try to resist it and you realize I can't because it's a more important, higher life for me to live, right? So you're kind of called to this. This is why the idea of saying, oh, just pick whatever you want to do with life in life is kind of right, but at the same time, it's got us well up from this because there's something more meaningful in this activity than my simple whim of saying, yeah, this sounds like fun.
Right, right. Because, and it's a recognition that self-fulfillment isn't fulfilling.
That's right. That's why you have to find something meaningful in life, which is calling you to it, and you realize that is therefore, like, sufficient evidence of, provided it's good, of vocational decision, because you have this higher life calling you, and so you don't need to think, but what about me? But because in some ways, if it's calling, it is you.
Right. Yeah. It corresponds with you naturally.
Yeah.
You can't resist it because it's the fulfillment of your nature.
Yeah. Right. And then the last thought, and then we'll wrap this up, is the idea, he says, the horizontal dimension seems to come about by way of transitioning from the child to the adult.
Uh-huh.
Whereas the vertical transcendence comes about actually in the reverse. It's by moving from the adult to the child, although he doesn't say that explicitly.
Uh-huh.
He does say going from the child to the adult, the type of maturity. But I think when it comes to the life of the spirit or the life of God or the divine life, it's actually by becoming the child, the one receptive of something completely beyond our ability to make any sense of it.
Right.
That we are capable of entering into that life.
But it's not just becoming a child. It's becoming a child post-adult.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
I mean, it's not just like, gosh, if we could just, if only we were all just kids bumbling around and looking at chicks, right? The kid reveals something about the perfection of man, but the kid is not perfected.
Right.
Because you can only be, the perfected one is the post-adult child.
As Jesus told Nicodemus, you have to be born of earth or what
water happened. And the spirit.
And, but that's the second time. The second time.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah,
so the second birth. Gotcha. The second birth. Right. So it's not simply all you need is the water and the spirit. You have to. It has to be a second birth.
Yeah. It has to be a second.
It has to be a second birth
in
order.
It has to be a second child.
In order for it to actually be water and spirit.
Yeah.
And it's got to be right out of the heart of freedom.